generalization is really important in this class. So whereas on Monday we had specific numbers here, 0.5, and specific initial values, I think there were 2 was the initial value, we want to be able to compare difference equations and differential equations in more general cases where we have arbitrary constants, in this case a k and a y sub zero, or y naught if you prefer. Why not? It's a little quicker to say. We want to be able to solve these things in those general cases and also understand what the solutions represent, how to think about them. As before, when we solve the difference equation, you can do it by pattern recognition in this fairly simple case. You've got this initial value y0. This equation would tell you how to find y1 to be k times y0. y2 would be k times y1. And that's true, but you don't want to stop there to get a general formula for yn that's a direct formula, not a recursive formula. You want to get this ultimately in terms of the initial condition. Replace that y1 with k times y0. And then simplify, k times k is k squared. y3 is going to be k times y2. But what's y2? y2 is k squared times y naught, giving you k cubed times y naught. That pattern continues. And ultimately, you can say that in general, y sub n, well, the subscript is going to match the power. It's going to be k to the n times y naught. Though it's a bit more traditional to put the y naught in front. You don't have to do that, though. You could also do k to the n times y naught. Actually, when we go to vectors and matrices, we'll put the y naught in the right because it'll make more sense to think of the initial condition as what's called a column vector, and it works better that way for vectors and matrices. But with scalar equations like this, this is fine and probably a little bit more typical. What about the differential equation? Remember what this equation was saying. It's saying the next value of y sub n, the nth value, is k times the previous value. The differential equation is saying something a little different. It's saying find a function of t, not y, t, because that's the independent variable, dy dt, whose derivative with respect to t is k times y. That's weird. How could it be k times y if it's a function of t? Because you got to think about it in the right way. It's k times the function is what this really represents. Y is a function of t. What function has a derivative that's k times itself? It's got to involve e. In fact, e to the kt. And in fact, any constant times e to the kt would work. Y of t, in terms of a general solution, has got to be an arbitrary constant times e to the kt. These are the functions whose derivatives are k times themselves, right? Because of the chain rule, k is a constant. Differentiate this, you'll get an extra factor of k. The derivative, dy dt, by the chain rule, gives you an extra factor of k, but that's the same as y. This is k times y. You got to think about these equations in this way. This is the initial thing about differential equations that's confusing for people. Y is a function of t. So again, we're not looking at that equation and saying, I guess the answer is k over 2 y squared plus e. No, you're not integrating the right-hand side with respect to y. You're asking, what function of t has a property that its derivative is always k times that function? In general, it's c times e to the kt, where c is an arbitrary, but if we also have this initial condition, and if I'm thinking of y zero, y naught as being something specific, that's actually got to be what c equals. Y of t has got to be y naught times e to the kt, because e to the zero is one, right? That's essential for making that work. If you replace t with zero, you get e to the zero, but e to the zero is one. Y naught times one is y naught. The c that you get, whether by guessing or integration, is not always equal to the initial value. In this case, it is. But you can always use the initial values to solve for c. This can also be solved by what's called separation of variables. Remember, the variables here are t and y, not k. K is a constant. What does separation of variables mean? It means get the y's on one side and the t's on the other side. How? I see a y on both sides. Maybe I should divide both sides by y? But how do I get the t on the other side? And what about the d? How do you deal with the d? Well, okay, it's a calculus kind of thing. Okay, here's what you do. Pretend dy dt is a fraction and multiply both sides, quote unquote, by dt. Right? You do this in your science and engineering classes, don't you? Is that really right? I mean, don't you have like a calculus teacher from your past who said dy dt is not a fraction? I tell my calculus students that, but I also tell them what I'm about to tell you now. It often doesn't hurt to pretend it's a fraction. Can this be justified, or is it all hand-wavy magic? It can be justified. Justification is not too hard. Maybe we'll talk about it on Friday. Really, it's an artifact of this Leibniz notation for the derivative, and just the fact that it's kind of weird. If you avoid Leibniz notation, then you can pretty easily justify it if you use ordinary function notation. Anyway, when you look at these kinds of things, because of the d's, you say to yourself, oh, I probably should integrate both sides. Yes, and go ahead and do that. On the right, you get kt plus c, but maybe I should call this c1. Maybe, because there's ultimately going to, that C1's going to be different than this C there. What about integrating that? Well, that's natural log of y, right? Or, well, okay, if you want to be more official about it, it's the natural log of the absolute value of y, as your calculus teacher told you. You want the most general antiderivative. Do I need a plus C here? Well, no. I mean, you could call put right a plus C2 or something, but then you could just subtract C2 from both sides and call that one C3. Okay. As long as you get the answer right at the end, it doesn't really matter, okay? So it's good enough to just have a constant of integration on one side. We're trying to solve for y as a function of t. We got a natural log of y there. I better exponentiate. Okay, this is a bit sloppy. I'm being more like a scientist, engineering, less like a mathematician, right? Being sloppy. These mathematicians are extra anal about stuff, right? You got to write things out in careful sentences. Ensure you work very, very carefully. Okay, I am a mathematician, and I often do that, but I can be sloppy too and even enjoy it. Guilty pleasures. So, right, it's like the E and natural log cancel because they're inverse functions, and you're left with the absolute value of y equals e to the kt plus c1, which now you can use a property of exponents that I wrote over on the board there to write that this way. And hey, maybe I'd like to get rid of that absolute value sign, so why not just do it? And why not just call that C, and here I guess we're done. That's an E there. Sorry, I'm having trouble making my E's today. Is this all hand-wavy math? Yes, it's very hand-wavy, sloppy math. But it does get you to the right answer. Is that good enough for mathematicians? No, it's not typically good enough. But we'll be a little bit forgiving here right now. I mean, you can sort of pseudo-justify this step in saying, well, I'm getting rid of the absolute value signs. E to the C1 would have to be positive, but here C could be negative. That's sort of like a pseudo-justification of getting rid of the absolute value sign. I will be a little bit more rigorous with this on Friday. Okay. Want to let you work in a few minutes, but we should do a few more things. We should take a step back and ask ourselves to describe the nature of these solutions. This one for the difference equation, and I guess it's this one for the differential equation. Initial value problem. What's the behavior of the solution? This is really important. Well, I guess it would depend on what y naught is and what k is, wouldn't it? Okay, let's think of it in terms of applications. In most applications I could imagine, it seems like y naught would have to be positive, right? If y is not as an initial value, why would you have a negative initial value? I mean, I suppose it could happen if like y was representing a height of something above the surface of the earth and you had a hole in the ground and so the ball could go underground, maybe even start underground at time zero. And so, yeah, why not could be negative, I guess, in that case. But most typical applications, it would not be. So why not is positive, say. How does the behavior of this depend on k? When would this grow to infinity, so to speak? What values of k would lead to this growing as n grows? It's a function of n. You're right. This grows, well, to infinity, or maybe I should put plus or minus infinity, when the absolute value of k is bigger than 1. That's correct. That's easier to think about if you just say k is bigger, k itself is bigger than 1. But it actually does grow, explode off to infinity, even if k is less than negative 1, like negative 2, for example. It's a quick way you can see this with the calculator. Pretend y naught is, just to pick a number, say 4. If k is 2, essentially this equation, if I keep using it first when n is 1, then when n is 2, then when n is 3, etc., I keep multiplying by 2. And that's what the original difference equation itself is saying, if k is 2. And this is growing off to infinity. 2 is bigger than 1 in absolute value. But this growing would happen even if the k were negative 2. Though the sign would oscillate negative, positive, negative, positive. So that's why I have the plus or minus there. On the other hand, if k has an absolute value less than 1, it decays to 0 when the absolute value of k is less than 1, like a half. So if my initial value is 4 and k is a half, I keep multiplying by 0.5 when I use the difference equation. And again, I could think of it in terms of the direct formula as well. But I keep hitting enter here. The numbers are decaying to 0. This works even if k is negative a half. Start with my initial, same initial condition there. Multiply by negative 0.5. These are still going to zero, though they are oscillating in sign, positive, negative, positive, negative. What if the absolute value of k is 1, like 1 or negative 1? If k is 1, 1 to the n is always 1. You always get the initial condition. It's constant. If k is negative 1, that number is going to oscillate between 1 and negative 1. The yn is going to oscillate between y0 and negative y0. So that's neither growing nor decaying. Constant when k is 1, oscillating without growing or decaying when k is negative 1. On the other hand, with the solution of the differential equation, again, pretend y0 is positive. This is going to grow to infinity if k is positive, and decay to zero if k is negative. It's different than this. Say it again. That's going to grow to infinity, right, if k is positive? I mean, grow to infinity as t goes to infinity. And it's going to decay to zero if k is negative, and be constant if k is zero. Not quite the same thing as this case. So these equations are similar in some ways, but they're different in other ways. Again, this is a discrete model. This is a continuous model.